Hey guys, it's Simon and welcome back to my LibGDX Kotlin tutorial series. So in the last part we learned how to add the audio stuff to our game, so music and sound effects and everything. And in this part we are going to learn how to save certain things to a so-called preference, so that you can save, for example, game settings, so how loud should the music be played, or also the game state. So in our case it will be the high score, so what is the maximum distance that our player traveled so far, and we want to display that then later on in a high score screen and menu and so on, so that players know how far they have traveled. So whenever our ship is alive, it travels a certain distance, and this distance is then stored in a so-called preference, and that is what we are taking care of in this part. One thing that I want to mention that happened in the last part, so when we developed the audio manager, I also added something to the dispose method of the game, which is that I go over all the music assets and I check the reference count to them. Because what I want to make sure with the way we implemented the music handling of our game, I want to make sure that actually one specific music asset is only referenced once. Because if we would have here two or three reference counters or multiple music assets multiple times, then they would not get disposed correctly with our load and unload functionality, and that's why I added that. And this could be useful for other assets as well, so if you want to keep track how many references are there to a certain asset, then you can use the asset storage get reference count. Then another thing that someone mentioned in the comments, and I want to elaborate on that as well, is the asset storage creation, because I think in the video I mentioned that the default setting is 2 threads, but this is actually wrong, because I looked it now up, and actually the default setting for the asset storage is new single thread async context, asynchronous context, so that means only 1 thread is used for the loading of the assets. But we actually anyway use coroutines from Kotlin, so they are not really a thread, they are a lightweight thread and are treated a little bit differently. But if you still want to increase the amount of threads, you can do that by passing in a different configuration for the coroutine context, and that one you could create with a new async context, and there specify the amount of threads that you want to use. So I think I used for the Quilly adventure game, I think I used 2 threads. That was the, for me, the fastest possible way to load all the different assets. And I think this is more than trying it out on different devices. What is the best setting there? Going too high with the amount of threads will most likely not increase the loading time, because there's always a specific overhead when it comes to creating additional threads. So this is really trying it out. Since we have a very small and simple game, for us it should be fine enough to have just a single thread, because the loading of the assets is already fast enough. But with that you can also play around a little bit. Okay, and today we are going to learn something about preferences. I will link again the official guidance to the comments below in the video. And preferences are actually nothing else than you can, like a hash map, so you can think of a map which has strings as keys and then several values for the basic data types, I would say, so integers, float, double, string, whatever. And especially with the string value, it gets then very powerful, because you can convert almost anything to a JSON object, which is a string representation of complex objects, let's say, in a specific notation. And with that, you could then actually store very complex things. So for example, in some of my games, I store the entire entity engine, so all entities and all components, in a string format, in a JSON string format, and save that in a preference. And the preference is then a file located on different locations, depending if it's run on the PC or Android phone or web browser or whatever. And you can also read then those preferences. And this is what we are going to learn today. So from a coding point of view, creating a preference is pretty simple. So we just create a new preference instance, and this is a preferences instance of combat-logic-gdx. Again, we initialized it lazily, so the first time we access it, it gets loaded. And then we simply call gdx app get preferences and pass in the name of our preference. So for example, dark matter YouTube. What this is doing, so if there would be already a preference available with that name, then it would load it. And if it's not available, then it would create this preference. So this is the simple part. So this is how to create it. And now we can store something in the preference and load something from the preference. And again, there is a KTX extension available for that to have it a little bit more in the Kotlin way, because by default, there would be for the different data types specific functions available. So put boolean, put float, put integer, put long, put string. But we don't want to write it like that. We want to have it more like something like this. So where key equals value. This is, in my opinion, more readable and easier to read and understand. And this is the power that the KTX extensions are providing us. So that's why we go to our build Gradle file, and there we add now a new extension, which I think is called, let's try it out, I think it's called preferences. Okay, that should be it. Let's try it out. So let's go back to our class here. So now we should have certain extensions like key equals 3.5. And for that, we should be allowed to import something. Ah, so doubles are not supported, then use a float. Okay, so this is then the syntax that we can use to write something to a preference. And the use case that we are looking into today is how do we store the distance of our player. So this will be the high score of the game to track the distance, the maximum distance traveled by the player. For that, first we need to go to our move system. And now we want to measure the distance that we traveled. So before we call move entity, which actually moves then the player to the new position, we first of all store the original position that he had, so which is actually just the y position. This is the distance that we use for the traveling. Then we move the player, and then we update the distance. So the player distance is then equals to the absolute amount of the new y position minus the old y position. So that means when the player is moving upwards, then the distance between the original one and the distance that he traveled upwards is then added to the total distance. And if he slowly gets sucked in backwards to the dark matter, then also the negative distance, let's say, will be added up to the player. That's why we use here the absolute amount, because if the player would move backwards, so going to the dark matter, it would be a negative amount, but we want always have a positive number for the high score and for the distance. So that's why we add it up here. So now we have this information available, and now the only thing that we need to do is to store this distance to our preference. So we switch to our game screen. There we already have the event function. And instead of now spawning the player immediately, we are going to store the distance in the preferences. So first of all, let's make here a debug message. So player died with a distance of the distance that we get from the event. And now we need access to our preferences. So there again, the usual behavior. So we go to our dark matter screen. We add here the preferences. And with that, we can now also use it in any of the screens. So we use it now in our game screen, where we say in our preferences, then let's call the key for that. This may be high score. And the value is the distance that we get from the event. Okay, the problem is that when you change something in the preference, it's not automatically written to the file in the background. For that, you always need to call the flush function. And there is also a KTX extension available for that. So we can write it like this. So preference is flush. Then here you can write all the different changes to your preferences. And in our case, it would be what we had here above. So we just want to set the distance. But of course, you could add here multiple things, and at the end of this block, the flush function is then called, and with that, in my opinion, it's more readable because you see immediately that the scope of the flushing and what kind of changes are happening and should be then persisted at the end of that scope here. Okay, so let's try that out. So I hope when we die that we already pass in the correct amount here, but let's see if it works. So I will try to simply not collect any power up and die as fast as possible. Again, the debug system would come into handy to make it happen faster. Okay, and now we died. We are still spamming, unfortunately, the console with this render calls information. But somewhere in here, okay, so we get already a number. So player died with a distance of 7. So we already get this information now. And what we actually do with this information is the following. So when we go to our user and to the dot preferences folder, this is the location, at least on Windows PCs, where the preferences get stored. So users, then your name, dot preferences. And there we have now our dark matter YouTube preference. And when we open that, so you can use, I usually use Notepad++, but you can use any text editor for that. Then you see, so it's simply an XML format file with the properties section. And there we have then the different key value pairs saved in it. So we have one entry currently, we have a high score entry, and we have the value 7 stored here. And we could now load that from the preferences and, for example, show that in the menu screen. So this is the saving part. Again, you need to call flush to really update this file. If you don't call flush, then nothing happens in the end. And with the call to GDX app get preferences, this file gets created if it would not be there. If it's there, then this entire content is simply loaded. So to also see how the loading is done, we simply go to our show method. We don't have a method menu yet. So we simply log a message here that we see how it would work. So log debug. And here we print now from our preferences the high score. So we have a high score value, which is a float, which could be a null value. So if I remember correctly, there are two ways to access these values. So the first one would be like this. So there we get back the value stored to that key, or null if it's not there. And another method would be, I think, get with a default value. But let me quickly check that. Okay, yeah, so we can write something like this. So when we specify a default value, then we are sure that the value is not null, because either we get it, the value that is stored, or we get this default value back. And if we don't specify the default value, then we could get back a nullable value, actually. So in our case, we simply want to print the high score, and if it's not there, let's make it 0 for the debug message for now. So that should be sufficient. And if everything works correctly, so if the key is also the same, we should see now here the message 6.9 or something when we go to the game screen. So let's see. So at the beginning of the game screen, yeah, so here you see it. So we print out this number. So we already loaded the value as well from the preferences. And that's actually everything that you need to know about the preferences. So it's a pretty simple topic, I would say. Let's repeat it quickly. So first of all, you need the preferences instance that you get with GDX app get preferences. It's stored in the user folders and you can treat it like a hash map. Then we use the libktx extensions to write and to set and load values from the preferences in a more Kotlin way. Then we updated the move system to set the distance of the player. And then you simply can call preferences flush and modify the preferences accordingly. So always with a key value pair. This will then store the information to the file. And with the load functionality, so with the getter, you can then get out the values from the preferences. And there are two versions, one with a default value so that you don't get back any nullable values, and without the default value, then you would get back a nullable value. Okay, that was a pretty short part, I would say. But a very important part for sure, because in almost every game you want to save something, and that's the easiest way how you can do that. So thanks for watching and see you in the next part. Bye bye.